An economic survey of Asia and Pacific region. I was one of the contributors. And during an expert review meeting in Bangkok, we had presented this issue. And elaborated examples can be found from that writings. And to find out if growth has been inclusive, some of the available indicators can be assessed therefore. You know, has income been increased? Has social and gender equity been maintained? And has access to opportunities improved? So if you respond to these questions, some answer may be found to, you know, value add to the existing goals and especially for different issues that you have given to us. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Thanks for excellent, insightful intervention, but also for magnificent time management. You took only 22 seconds more than 5 minutes. So, excellent. So now…
Indicator was this.
Thank you. Now to Professor Mustafizur. And he would be covering rights and justice.
Thank you, Chair, distinguished panelists, dear guests. I think this is an incredibly important session that we are having. And I think that the whole gamut of the SDGs and the ethos of the SDGs and the ecosystem in which the SDGs are implemented are captured by the notion of justice and right. I think we have to keep that in mind. And Chair, you have very rightly mentioned about right to development, and you have recalled the contribution, seminal contribution of Professor late Arjun Sengupta in this. And I would like to recollect the 1986 Declaration of the Right to Development. And it says that everyone is entitled to participate and contribute to economic, social, cultural, and political development in which all human rights and fundamental freedoms can be fully realized. States have the duty to cooperate with each other in ensuring development and eliminating obstacles to development. The right to development is not about charity, but about entitlement and empowerment. I think it's in 1986, and we have committed to it, and I see a reflection of the MDGs and now the SDGs in that right to development. And if we look at it from that perspective, I think the whole issue of sustainable development, when we call about sustainable development, define it as development of the current generation that does not jeopardize the development of the future generation. Okay, that's how, and we relate it to, often we relate it to environmental issues. But I would like to argue that sustainable development in that sense is also how we address the vulnerabilities, you know. So I think that that's what makes development sustainable. It's just not one dimension of the environment. If we are not inclusive, if we are not doing justice to those who are left behind, then the societal tensions that emerge, that undermines the development of the future generation. I think that no less important than environment. And from that perspective, I think that the issue of rights and justice, and that it's not a charity, but it's empowerment and entitlement, I think that is very important. And that brings me to my second issue, which is that if that be the case, can we, you know, make them inclusive by delivering the same level of services? No, I think I have read in one of the, you know, debates that was put forward in the Indian discourse with regard to positive discrimination. And one of the judges said that if in society people are inequitably situated, you cannot make them equal by giving them equal treatment. You can only make them equal by giving them unequal treatment. So I think that that is what, you know, is in the core. And I would like to also mention about what Professor Amartya Sen in his book, Development as Freedom. And he said that we have to address participation deficit, non-discrimination, and distributive justice. So I think that these are the three very powerful, you know, issues that we have to address. And in his book, The Idea of Justice, Professor Sen writes, you know, the question that homo economicus or rational economic men are motivated mainly by self-interest is not true. He points out that children have their own strong notion of fairness, an acute aversion to manifest injustice. This aversion to manifest injustice also applies to adult human being. What moves us reasonably enough is not the realization that the world falls short of being completely just, which few of us will expect, but that there are clearly remediable injustices around which we have to eliminate. So I think that this idea of justice, as espoused by Professor Sena, is also very strong motivation for us to really address the issues of those who are left behind. Now, we have to understand who are left behind in a contextual sense. And Mr. Thierry, in his very excellent presentation, has mentioned about some of the elements of the vulnerabilities. In the Bangladesh context, we, through consultation, we had tried to identify who are the vulnerables in our context. And we have found out 12 elements of vulnerabilities, and we have to address them with concrete interventions. One is the life cycle. You know, if you grow older, then many of us will become vulnerable. Civil identity, disability, education, lack of education skills, gender, geographical location, health issues, income, occupation, religion and ethnicity, sexual orientation, shock-induced vulnerabilities. I think that we have to identify which are the elements and then take concrete steps. And these concrete steps have to be taken not only at the national level. I think that the global community also has a duty. And often what we are seeing is that whilst our national governments are taking steps in order to address, and in Bangladesh, for example, $928 billion of additional money will be needed. So it's very difficult to generate this. So there was also a talk about global support. So on the one hand, we have to have our own fiscal policies in place. But on the other hand, I think the global institutions, supposed to give the support, 0.7% of the GNI for the developing countries, 0.15% of the GNI equivalent as aid to the LDCs. I think that also has to be there. So I think the idea of justice is not only delimited to what our governments do or our stakeholders do, but also the global community also has a responsibility. I would like to emphasize that, and I can see, Chair, that I have passed my time. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. As always, Mr. Bazarbai, extremely rich and insightful. Thanks for this. To discuss same issue of rights and justice, I now turn to Mr. Pradeep Baishak. He is Asia Coordinator for Global Call to Action Against Poverty.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Sachin, honored to be presenting our ideas on inequality, justice, and rights in this panel. After Professor Rehman's conceptual narrative on justice and rights, I'll be focusing mostly on the actions that we are doing and we are planning to do, primarily on inequality, but within that understanding of inequality, the issues of rights and justice. I am representing here both the Global Call to Action Against Poverty and Asia Civil Society Partnership on Sustainable Development. I'll not speak much about GCAP. GCAP is a global campaign, works in 58 countries, primarily on inequality and poverty. And in South Asia, we are present in Afghanistan, Pakistan, India, Nepal, Sri Lanka, and Bangladesh. Even though we are global, the way network functions is it's deeply embedded in grassroots. And we mostly work on bottom-up fashion, and our target groups are the most vulnerable groups. It is their voice which we try to highlight. Very quickly, one or two good practices that we have done on sustainable development. I'm sure you'll be fascinated to know that. In 2017, we thought just the policy framework and implementation directions will not be enough to achieve SDGs. What is needed is the mass pressure. In 2017, along with UN SDG Action Campaign and GCAP, then Action for Sustainable Development joined with us, the Asia Civil Society, etc. Together, we started a mass campaign, tried to bring in the masses to the street in a very peaceful manner to highlight, to raise their voices, highlight their issues by different forms of mass action. That is, the idea is to empower people so that their voices are galvanized and the police, it reaches to the policymakers. Generate awareness, seek accountability from the government, and create the desired impact. Numbers are huge, numbers are there. Across the globe, kind of, it's underestimated number, 1 million people in 1,200 cities and rural areas in 142 countries participated, but that's underestimated number. The real number is much more. People like one of our friends is here, people like Mangaram, has discussed SDGs, one of the remote villages in Haryana. Those are the kind of spread that we have tried to achieve. Forms of actions needed, various rallies, photo stunts, selfies, sports and painting competitions, candlelight march, cycle march, memorandums to the prime ministers, public meetings, and across the social media, massive social media use to also capture the imagination of the netizens. These campaigns are mostly led by the groups who need the SDGs the most. The youth, the women, the children, persons with disabilities, indigenous communities, Dalits, and others. Very kind of snapshot, workshop in Nepal on third anniversary. This mass mobilization we are doing on actually anniversaries of such an adoption of Agenda 2030 on September 25 or around September 25. Aging people are participating on leasing power on and pitching in for implementation of SDGs. It's like one, in Sri Lanka, this group of people came and did a huge banner of 1.2 kilometers on the coast of Sri Lanka. Rallies in Pakistan happened, children in India are spreading awareness. You can see the energy and enthusiasm of the young people to on SDGs and their expectations too. Girls are having hand painting on SDGs in India. That's leave no one behind. And a group of people are in front of part of photo stand, the stand-up campaign on SDGs in front of the parliament in Bangladesh. So those are the kinds of actions we have done in South Asia and of course across the globe. Very quickly, these are good practices. Most of us know, but this is an opportunity. Regionally, there are civil society groups which have come to engage in implementation of SDGs, apart from the awareness building, capacity building, engagement with the UN systems. APRSM is such a platform which, thanks to the our friends at SCAP, APRSM is kind of consistently engaged, providing the space for civil society engagement with the UN systems. Then Asia Civil Society Partnership, the Independent Civil Society Partnership, which is doing capacity building, information sharing, and we are also kind of, this time we supported the civil society processes in Sri Lanka and Laos during the VNR processes. And then we have Asia Development Alliance also doing independently and with APSD, the capacity building, etc. And we have Asia Dalit Rights Forum, which is Asia Dalit Rights Forum, which has linked the identity-based inequality groups, indigenous communities, and Dalits with SDGs, doing a lot of advocacy and documentation.
So your time is up.
One more. Okay. So nationally also we are doing, but the one that I tried to bring in is the Faces of Inequality campaign that GCAP is doing. Through this, where we will be doing at least in 4 countries inequality reports. And what we'll try to bring is the faces, just not the numbers. Do not invisibilize them. Do not put it them only numbers. So bring in the faces so that these groups, marginalized groups in different countries will be consulted. Their issues of rights and justice will be highlighted. And that will come in the inequality reports that we are planning. And we are trying to, from this point of view, we are trying to influence the discourse of inequality globally, of course, in southern region. priorities bring aggressively the human rights issue as part of inequality discourse and discourse of SDGs. Tax justice is extremely important. It's just not the ODA. So much of our money is going away to the tax havens. And so bring it back. Essential services, access to social protection, decent work, gender justice, impacts of climate change on marginalized people, on food security, etc. Financial inclusion and budget. These are the priority areas which I think we should be focusing on in coming days. Thank you.
Thanks, Mr. Baishak, for this interesting presentation. Now, friends, we move to the next section, which is about participation and voice. And I'm so glad that Shri V.K. Piparsenia could join us. Mr. Piparsenia was Chief Secretary of Assam from 2015 to 2018. And Assam emerged as India's first state as one which has set up a separate entity for implementation of sustainable development goals. And what impressed me always was this vigor and commitment with which Assam could bring in all different actors, all different departments, and all different stakeholders together. So